This may be part of your assignment problem also. First one is, there is a Deakin process in which you have 2 HCl plus half O2 gives you, this is for chlorine manufacture. Data is available, delta GF 298 and delta HF 298 is available and CP average is available over the range of temperatures. This is we call this 1, 2, 3 and 4. 1, this is minus 2 is oxygen, okay, 3 is water. See, I have got this mixed up. Sorry. Then this is 1, 2, 3, 4. For HCl, it is minus 22, 778. This is minus 57,798, 4 is 0, minus 57,798. I think I will leave the CP average, you do not need this. Skip the data. If the data is not given, you just assume delta CP is 0 for the reaction. Finally, there is another curious information. This is typical of industrial optimization by T squared. You have to do this operation at some temperature and pressure. The question is, what is the optimum value of temperature at which you should run this reactor? And this cost has been, this is based on 80% conversion of oxygen to chlorine. This is data. The first thing is you have to get delta G as a function of temperature for the reaction. So you are looking at, basically the reaction formulation is simply at equilibrium, you are looking at 2 minus 2 x, this is HCl plus half oxygen giving you H2O. Plus Cl2, 2 minus 2 x, you start with 2 moles and half a mole, half into 1 minus x, and this is x moles, this is x moles. Your Kf is simply, sorry, Kφ times P by total moles to the power delta nu, then Kn. This of course is equal to exponential of minus delta G0 by RT. This cost that they have worked out is purely based on operational considerations. And they have a compressor, they have a heating element, they note the cost of energy for heating and so on. Usually given empirically for a range. So I have this. Now at the moment we will set k phi equal to 1. This pressure to the power delta nu is 2 here and 2.5. So delta nu is minus half. It is just the sum over nu I. So it is 1 and 1 for water and chlorine and 2 and minus 2 and minus half. So you get essentially total moles. Minus 2 x minus half x I have, so 2.5 minus half x or 5 minus x by 2. So I have 5 minus x by 2 p to the power half. K n is of course x squared by 2 squared is 4. This to the power half by root 2 or 2 root 2 into 1 minus x. This is to the power 2, it is to the power half, so this is to the power 5 by 2. So I have essentially exponential of minus delta g 0 by r p. Oxygen conversion is simply x, and in this case it is the desirable oxygen conversion is given as 0.8. Thermodynamics gives you some equations. In every reaction engineering problem in the industry you will have some special constraints. They will decide how much of conversion they need. What is the minimum conversion they will accept, and this has been worked out at 80% conversion. It is possible that downstream use of chlorine in this particular application may have had in a particular plant may require some oxygen to be present with it, depends on the application to which the final product is. Also they may have found that it is, we can also do that calculation, we can found that it is uneconomical, the cost increases tremendously when you try to increase the conversion beyond that point, but we can double check that. But this is, so first you have to find delta G0 by RT, you have to know this is a function of temperature, is equal to some function of pressure and conversion. So if X is known, P becomes a function of temperature, so the cost becomes a function of temperature alone. That function of temperature differentiated and set equal to 0 will give you the optimal temperature. If you look at delta G0, d of delta H0 by dt is delta Cp, I am going to take this as 0, then d delta G0 by T by dt is equal to minus delta H0 by T square. So if you integrate this you get delta G0 by T minus delta G0 298 by 298. I am integrating this over T, will give you minus delta H0 which is now a constant, or plus delta H0 into 1 by T which is 1 by T minus 1 by 298. My recommendation in reaction engineering is in reaction equilibrium calculations is don't simplify these numbers, carry them as it is and do the calculation only in the last step. Otherwise you make silly mistakes here and there and sometimes they cancel out, you are unnecessarily calculating these numbers. Now at this stage you have delta at 298, First of all, delta H0, you just take this difference, you have to take H2O minus 2HCl. This is H2O, that is 2HCl. So it is 57 this is constant, so you get minus 57,798 plus 44,128. This is 76,17,30. And this is at 290. This is the same at all temperatures. Delta G0 298, it is because delta Cp is 0, otherwise you would have carried it. This is minus 54,635 plus 56,552, so 45,556. So I need delta G0 by T by RT. It will give you delta G0 by R into 298, and I think this is given in, I think all of this is calories per gram mole. No, I have not noted the units, it must be calories per gram. You have a factor of 2, again do not calculate delta G0 and then calculate delta G0 by RT again, you need only delta G0 by RT. So delta G0 by R into 298, this is 9079 by 2 into 298 minus delta H0 is minus, or I will make this plus, 13,670 by 2, this is T minus 298, by 298 into T. Delta G0 by RT is equal to, I have this 9079 and this, there is something wrong. No, this is okay. 2 into 298, so this is 13,670 minus 9079 591 and 13,491 by 2 into 298. This is a plus, then minus 13,670 by 2 into T. What is this equal to? 7?
7.70.
Okay, 7.70 minus, this is again 6835 by T. So exponential of this or exponential of minus of this is equal to 5 minus x power half, x is equal to 0.8, so it is 4.2 by 2 or 2.1, square root of 2.1 by square root of p, and then there is a 2 root 2. Root 2 in the denominator, I put 2 root 2 here. Then x squared by 1 minus x, so 0.8 squared or 0.64 divided by 0.2 to the power 5 by 2, all those are numbers, into just 1 by square root of p. So finally your cost p to the 0.1 by t squared easier to solve for so d of cost by dt is equal to 0 implies p to the power 0.1 into 2t should be equal to t squared 0.1 p to the power minus 0.9. So this t will cancel and this is when p, if you bring this to the side, this is just p, p is equal to 0.05t. It should be, sorry, this is dp by dt, this must be multiplied by dp by dt, p prime. So p is equal to p by p prime, so you really have to, because if you are putting this equal to 0, you are saying essentially p prime by p should be equal to 20 by t, so that you have to substitute in this. You have to solve these two equations to get t or p, whichever is convenient. You tell me what t comes out to be. You do this by trial and error. This is what you are doing, is you are saying p is equal to, what is this equal to? Okay, that sounds right. And you have 0.2 to the power, okay. So you have essentially p is equal to 18.3 squared by exponential of minus 15.4 plus e power minus, so minus 15.4 plus 6835. So p prime, easier to keep the exponential in the numerator. Keep it in the numerator. The exponential is p is equal to, just change the sign, 68 minus 6835 by t. Yeah, into 2. You are right. So 70. 136.70 by t plus 15.4. So p prime is going to give me back this p, and it will get exponential of minus 13.670. I have to just differentiate this, that is included in p. And if I differentiate this with respect to t, I get into 13.670 by t squared. P prime is dp by dt. So p by p prime is t squared by 13.670. You are saying this should be equal to 0.05 t, or t is equal to 13.670 into 0.05. Advantage of not simplifying anything as far as possible, otherwise you would have computed all those exponentials and gone down to details. How much does it come to? 683.5. Incidentally, in all these empirical correlations where they give you cost, they will say this is valid only within a range. In this case, it says 300 to 800 degrees, so this comes within that. You have to verify, otherwise these things can go haywire. Because in costs you never know, suddenly there will be a step change. It will be a temperature up to which mild steel is allowed in heat exchangers. Then they will say it is not strong enough, so change to copper or something, or change to something else, and the cost difference will be huge. So in all empirical cost correlations you have to be very careful. It simply depends on the local market prices. So what does the pressure come out to be? 3.36. Actually, the cost correlation was actually much more complicated than this. I think it is given in an old issue of Industrial Engineering Chemistry, 1947 or 48. I do not know if that issue is even available here. Because it is only to illustrate a principle, I simplified it to this form. It is actually given as a long polynomial in pressure and so on, some count. But the principle is trivial, simply, and eventually you will probably solve it on the computer anyway. So this is typical, it is just cumbersome calculations, but otherwise the principle of it is fairly straightforward. Because it is 3, your k phi calculate, you have to verify one more step. Once you know p, you can calculate your k phi and check that it is in fact approximately 1. In any case, you do not tell an industry to operate at 3.36 atmospheres, you will probably give them some 3.5, some rounded off number. So the fellow has a pressure gauge that fluctuates widely, so he would not know whether he is actually reading 3.5 or 3. Probably within point plus or minus 0.5. I will take another example. This is simultaneous reactions. I have got some more data. So every time what happens is you have the equilibrium equations plus special constraints, could be in the form of a volume of a reactor, It could be in the form of total volume being constant, could be in the form of. Before I take simultaneous reactions, let me give you another example. This is HF. HF is known to polymerize in the gas phase. It does not exist as HF, it exists as HNFN. The question is, what is N? Usually there is some guess about it, N is equal to 4 or 6. They are asking you to find out from experimental data on the reaction whether N is 4 or 6. The data given are in the following form. A temperature in degrees K, your pressure is given in atmospheres, and then the vapor density is given in gram moles per liter. If it says vapor density of HF, it means the density has been measured assuming that the gas is HF. It may actually be H4, F4, H6, F6, etc. So the data given is 293, I am sorry, 298, the other way around, 298, and then two measurements at 323, and the pressure is given. This is two different pressures, and then 373 also, and 5.6. And the vapor density 190 273 0.070 0.199. What you are asked to do is first what is N, and then find delta G0 and delta H0. I think this is given at different temperatures, these are asked at 298. It is a silly thing, but you have to be careful in reaction equilibrium because you are taking these exponentials. So in you end up with order of magnitude errors, and because you have no industrial exposure as such, you do not have a feel for numbers. You do not know whether conversion is supposed to be 0.1 or 0.9. So you will end up, so you have to be careful with numbers as far as possible. Do not do that calculation till the end. Then if you are fortunate, you do not have to do the calculation at all. So you did not have to do an exponential calculation here except for a constant. How will you proceed with this? How will you find out? How will you test this hypothesis? Start off is always initial. You have say N moles and 0 moles. At equilibrium, you are not using HF. Let us assume there are X moles here, then this is N into 1 minus X. So total moles is n minus 1 into x. So compared to the initial moles, total moles by initial moles is a factor of 1 minus, because I am just dividing by n. If you had measured the density as HF, this is what you would have got, but the actual number of moles is 1 minus 1 by n into x. Depending on the fraction converted to, right. So the density, if you want to, you have P, the pressures are quite small, we will assume ideal gas, you will get essentially number of moles, which is 1 minus 1 by n into x into dRT. This is D. The vapor density is D. Assuming ideal gas, if they give you an equation of state, you can use the equation of state. If it had remained as HF, then you can verify that P by dRT, if you put n equal to 1 for example, then that term will disappear, you can verify if P is equal to dRT, you can see it is not. How you proceed further? What is your Kf for the reaction? Kf is K phi times P by total number of moles to the power delta nu into Kn. We will take K phi as 1, and pressure is of course there known, total number of moles n minus 1 x. To the power of the change in number of moles is 1 minus n, right, this is n moles giving you 1 mole, so it is 1 minus n. And then you have Kn, Kn is simply x by n into 1 minus x to the power n. Now I have got two readings at 323, the same temperature but at different pressure. Kf has to be the same for those two. So we will do the Kf calculation here for n equal to 4 and Kf for n equal to 6. As 4 and 6 are guessed on the basis of the structure of HF, the way the valence bonds are stuck and so on. So you have to know a bit of chemistry and some feel, but in this case you are told that it is either 4 or 6 that they do not know, or else you can try out n equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in this case you get two possibilities, Kf for n equal to 4 is simply 1 by P cube. Is 4 minus 3x cube into x by 4 into 1 minus x to the power 4. So you have P by dRT that you can calculate here. Let me strike this off. Before you do this, you have to do this. P by dRT. D is given, P is given, CC atmospheres, so make sure R is in the right units. You calculate your P by dRT. From P by dRT you can get n. In terms of, you can get n and x, n in terms of x or x in terms of n. And x for n equals 4 and n equals 6. Then you do the Kf calculation. We have from here x is equal to P by dRT. 1 minus P by dRT. Divided by 1 minus 1 by n. Once you have K, then you can calculate Kf for n equals 4 and n equals 6. So, can you run through this with the calculator? What is P by dRT here? RT, you have to take, is the temperature given? I think it says 300 degrees. Oh no, temperature is here, sorry. So, R of course, you can take R as 82 cc atmospheres per gram mole. So, you have to do this, 1.4 by D into this, into this. If this is liters, sorry, so this is 0.082 liters, you have to take it in liters. So, do it in liter atmospheres. So, tell me what P by dRT is in these 4 cases. Yeah.
0.3015.
This one. 0.3015. Yes.
0.3872.
Okay. Next one.
720.
Okay, then x for x is simply 1 minus x for n equals 4, 1 minus p by dRT. This is 1 by 4, so this is 3 by 4 into 4 by 3. And x for n equals 6 is 6 by 5 into 1 minus p by dRT. Around 0.9, you do the numbers carefully. First one is 817, is it?
931.
This is 931. Okay, second one? Point?
817.
This is all for n equals 4.
Yeah.
Okay.
0.327.
0.107. For n equals 6. It's actually only 80% of this. You can just calculate 0.8 times, because you're doing the same 1 minus. So if you do 0.8 times, how much is it? 3 decimal places, I won't take more. This is 4. Pardon me? This is 0.8 times this, right? Because it's 6/5/4/3 into this.
0.9.
This is how much? 9. You should get 0.8 times this, because this is simply 6/5. This divided by this is simply 0.8, right? This by this, because you get 6/5/4/3, 9.9 times. Sorry, you are right. Okay. 0.838. 09. Okay. Now finally, for the truth, KF. This is the test. In fact, you need to do these two first, because if KF is not constant at a given temperature, then that model isn't right. So you need to do the middle ones. The expressions are different, remember, for KF for n equals. For n equals 6, this is 6 minus 5x to the power 5 by p to the power 5 into x by 6 into 1 minus x. To the power 6. Equal to 4, what is the value? 0.34. Okay. Not 624. So this sort of rules it out. But what about n equals 6? Since it's your last option, it may as well be right. Not 6, 9, 8 and not 6, 9, 3 saved. So once you've got that, you take an average value for this, then you calculate this and you calculate this value, then you calculate your delta G0 and your delta H0 by differentiation. That means you should really plot. In this case, you got a lot of scatter, so you have got to plot delta G0 by 298, by T. It is d by dt of this against T. D by dt is delta H0, so you will get a straight line. You will get, you got only 3 points. So you draw a straight line and take the slope of that, it should give you delta H by T square. You are actually asked to calculate it only at 298. If you do this once, you get some idea of the kinds of errors you can expect, because these vapor, this particular vapor density measurement is a very accurate measurement. It was taken directly from Journal of Chemical Engineering data, and it has the, this is about as accurate as you can get with vapor density measurements. This itself is pretty unambiguous. You got only 1% error essentially, but in many cases you have to make a judgment. I mean, you have to decide that this is good enough, or within 5% this is all right and so on. The actual crucial part here was this, relating the vapor density, but it is always given in terms of the description of the molecule. If it says HF, then means vapor density is reported assuming that all molecules are HF.